Hi everyone. Thanks for joining us today to discuss managing anxiety and stress with a cancer diagnosis. I'm Karen Fasciano, a clinical psychologist at Dana-Farber, Brigham and Women's Cancer Center in Boston. And I'm joined today by a panel of current and former cancer patients who have agreed to share their experiences with stress and anxiety during their cancer treatment. Let's meet them. Kat Caverly is an artist. She was diagnosed with breast cancer in 2013, and she had fun chronicling her journey through the lens of her camera. You can follow her on Twitter at Kat Cavalry. Thanks for joining us, Kat.
Hi, it's Kat Caverly.
Noel Dawes is a 68-year-old retired British Army officer who currently lives in Glen Falls, New York. Noel had a successful stem cell transplant in July 2012 for a rare primary myelofibrosis. You can follow Noel on Twitter at Noel Dawes. Welcome, Noel. Chris Kazarian was originally diagnosed with leukemia at 17 and relapsed at 22 after graduating from college. He received a cord blood transplant last February and has since been treated at the Jimmy Fund Clinic for graft versus host disease. He blogs at countercutter.com, and you can follow him on Twitter at ChrisGaz. And lastly, Carolyn Ringe, who was diagnosed with ovarian cancer at the age of 30. She recently had a recurrence at the age of 32. She, as a young adult with cancer, has faced many unique challenges, including interruption of her studies to become a nurse. You can follow Carolyn on Twitter at CR1682. Welcome, Carolyn.
Hey everyone.
Thank you all for sharing your experiences with us today. Those of you watching at home can also follow the conversation on Twitter using the hashtag DFCIHangout. Or tweet your questions to Dana-Farber using the hashtag or email them to social@dfci.harvard.edu. Okay, let's get started. My first question is, what did it feel like when you got the news of your cancer diagnosis? Chris or Kat, do you have?
Well, it felt overwhelming.
I can't hear.
And my first thought was, I don't want to die. So I didn't know enough when I got the diagnosis to know what to do next. I'm not sure if you're hearing me or not, but I hope you are. And so, at 58, I still thought I was too young to die.
Yeah, for me, it was I was 17 years old, and so I was still kind of young enough where it was the last thing I really expected, and I hadn't had any experience with cancer at all, so, it was a shock, and it kind of just washed over me when I originally heard that diagnosis, and there was so much about it that I didn't know or understand or know what to expect. So it was scary, but and emotional, and after that, you slowly sort of start to process it and everything. But that original moment was, I remember being very just shocking and sort of surreal. Even it's kind of like the last thing you would expect, So.
Carolyn, Noel, do you have anything to add? No, we can't hear you over here. Could you check your mic?
I can hear him.
Well, let me move on to the next question. I have a question for Carolyn. After the initial shock of your cancer diagnosis, many people sort of focus on what their treatment plan is and getting themselves and their social support system together to figure out how to cope with these new changes. Did getting your treatment plan make you more or less anxious?
When I got my treatment plan, I kind of just dove into the treatment and felt initially with my first diagnosis that as long as I was doing the treatment, then I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. But I found that I actually had a lot of anxiety and stress, and my oncologist suggested that I go speak to a therapist and that it might be helpful to get some emotional support through my diagnosis, which ultimately was the best thing for me. And with my recurrence, that was where I immediately started back again, was with the emotional support to help me through this process, because it is very anxiety causing, and it was very difficult with the treatment plan. So
Noel, do you have anything to add to that?
Well, yes, I do, but can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now, Noel.
Okay, well, that's that's good. Now, in the first place, you know, when we first got the diagnosis, we were obviously very shocked, and after investigating and finding out what it was all about a little bit, I think my wife and I, my wife's my caregiver, came to the initial conclusion that we wanted to follow, I think, two or three principles in the treatment of this. First of all, I'm a former infantry officer, so we were going to keep on assaulting the enemy being the myelofibrosis. We weren't going to give up. We were going to carry on. So we had a cup of tea. The second thing is we wanted to make sure that throughout the whole of this process, whatever it led to, we would retain our senses of humor. And the third one, I have to say now, I talk from my personal experiences of strong faith in Christ, and so we wanted to be able to use this illness as a blessing and an encouragement and a way of bringing hope for other people as well as for myself. So that's the first thing. And then when we got the treatment plan, I was told there were two options to this illness, and the first option was palliative care, and the second option was a stem cell transplant. So we went through about a year and a half of evaluating those two and checking on my progress, and certainly was more anxious because the palliative care one was another way of saying you've got about 5 years to live. And I didn't fancy that idea too much. The stem cell transplant we really didn't know about until we started talking to the doctors. And eventually it hinged on one doctor at Dana-Farber, Dr. Stone, saying to me, well, which treatment option you go for depends on what your aims are for the future. And I thought, well, my aim is to see my grandkids graduate from high school in about 15, 16 years' time. So it became a no-brainer that we were going to go for the transplant. I did start down the road of a clinical trial and started to apply for that, but discovered that the results of that particular clinical trial for a drug weren't as good as were being hoped for, so we rather discarded that idea early on. So I was more anxious, but my faith has allowed me to find a lot of peace in all of this, and don't know if that's helpful for somebody.
Thanks for sharing that, Noel. You gave us a lot of good things to think about. It sounds like your faith and also continuing to live during this and engage in your life outside of cancer were very important to you.
Thank you, yes.
So let me move on to the next question. none of us go through our cancer alone. It impacts people who care about us and our communities. And I was wondering if any of you had any thoughts about what was difficult for you to watch in terms of the stress and anxiety of your caregivers and how they managed that and how it might have been different or the same than how you managed it.
Yeah, I have something to say about that. You know, I think going through all my treatments and everything, I really, you know, recognize how important it is to have the support of you know, the, you know, really close caregivers, whoever that is in your life. For me, it was my parents and my girlfriend and some friends, you know, but there's so much stress and anxiety and worries that come with the cancer diagnosis, and, you know, I think that they, you know, your caregivers are experiencing the same worries, and in some ways those fears and anxieties are, you know, very similar to what you're experiencing, but also they're experiencing them in a different way, you know, and maybe even like in, they might feel even more helpless than you because they have to just sort of watch everything happen to you. So I've always found that it's like, for me at least, it was always really important to do whatever I could in terms of making an effort to just keep our relationship strong and remember that they're experiencing all of this with me, and making a point to kind of, whenever I could, however I could, you know, remind them that I understood that this was hard for them too, and that, you know, because I think a lot of times when you see a loved one going through cancer, it's really easy to hold your own sort of worries in because you don't want to add extra burdens onto them. And, you know, I didn't want them to have to feel that way when we interacted. I wanted our relationships to remain as open and honest as they always were, because, you know, I understood that they were feeling those same fears that I was, and even in a different way. So really that was so important for me, and I think that was something good to be, you know, aware of when you're going through something like this.
Thanks. That was really helpful in terms of understanding how you saw your caregivers and how you thought about how you could help them with their anxiety or stress related to this. Carolyn, did you have something to add?
Yeah, I actually, one thing that I learned, which is, you know, obviously it's very important to have support, but I also found that it was important for me to take care of myself as an individual going through cancer, and to not worry as much about those around me. My parents had a difficult time dealing with my cancer diagnosis. My sister handled it with humor. I lost a lot of friends who couldn't handle my diagnosis or didn't know what to say. So I really just started to focus on what my needs were. And by doing that, it allowed me to take care of myself and then still be engaged with those individuals in my life. But I was getting the support that I needed, and not feeling the guilt and the anxiety that was going along with, you know, what they were feeling. So
are you saying in some ways taking care of yourself helped you to take care of them?
Yes, absolutely.
It's interesting. For me, my wife had cancer about four or five years before mine was diagnosed. One of my granddaughters had also had cancer when she was 18 months old, so the role of caregiver was sort of reversed around the other way. I had been the caregiver for my wife, now she's the caregiver for me. I think we were obviously worried about the future and what that held, and I think the fear of apprehension of me not being there at one stage, at some stage, was not greatly comforting for my wife. Other people had different reactions. We live fairly close to my son and his family, I don't know, they just seem to accept it. They're worried, concerned, but we basically, I think, got on with day-to-day living as best we could. People from elsewhere around us, I have another son in the UK, I think they were possibly, because they were away and apart from us, were more anxious about the diagnosis. I think some people had already got me in the grave already anyway. Yeah, it's a difficult time, it's a stressful time, but I think we tried to just live each day as it came and deal with each day as it came, and we had many, many journeys to and from Boston. It's about a 3.5 to 4 hour drive for me, for us to go to Boston. We were down there at one stage virtually every week for months on end. But people reacted in different ways, and we just learnt, I think, to accept the way they reacted and carry on. Good old British quality, carry on.
Do any of you have an example of when you realized that your way of coping with anxiety and your caregiver's way of coping with anxiety was actually quite different, and that caused some conflict or tension?
Oh, both me and my husband do deal with stress in a similar way with humor. But after I was diagnosed, I caught my husband sadder than I'd ever seen him before. And so I started singing and dancing to cheer him up at a time when it was darkest for me, and that cheered me up. But when chemo was raging through my veins, I got very self-centered, and I didn't care what anyone else thought, and I didn't want to take care of anyone else. And I told my husband, "You're not allowed to feel worse about my cancer than I do." And the reaction he had told me he does feel worse about it, and he's allowed to feel worse about it, and that anything that I could do to make him feel better helped me. So I just kept singing and dancing.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I think I'm the sort of person that wants to really say to people, come on, buck up, get out of it, just be your normal self. When my wife was very apprehensive and so on, I tend to come across quite strongly in that way, and that's not helpful for her. And I mentioned earlier on that about our faith, we have a joint faith together. There was one particular passage which really spoke to me about how I should relate to her. I shouldn't be this sort of guy saying, come on, buck up, get on with life. That I should really minister to her needs perhaps more than I was doing. And if you don't mind, I'm just going to read it. It's just a few words which talk about how everything I do and say should be designed to bring the best out of my wife. That's my aim. And so I then decided I needed to revise my attitudes a little bit and try and be a little bit more graceful to her as she was trying to cope with adjusting to this illness and so on. And so I think that certainly was helpful for me as I tried to be more graceful towards her and to bring the best out of her rather than think about myself all the time.
Thank you. Thank you all for sharing many different perspectives on how to both take care of yourself and your own needs and how to take care of the needs of your caregivers, and also how to negotiate and reevaluate things when you are coping very differently at a particular time than your caregiver might be. So let me move on to the next question. And this has to do with if there are specific moments that cause you more anxiety than other moments in your care. For example, you know, many, many people I talk with have an enormous amount of anxiety waiting for the results of their scans. Other people have an enormous amount of anxiety anticipating a chemotherapy treatment. I'm just wondering, for you, what were the things in your treatment that created the most anxiety for you, and how did you cope with that?
If you don't mind, one of the experiences that I had, I was told that I had a very high chance of my cancer recurring. It was 75 to 90% because I was diagnosed at stage 4. I had a lot of trouble coping with the unknown, what was coming next, because my oncologist couldn't tell me whether or not I was going to be in a small percentage of people that made it through and beat this cancer, or if it would come back. So really learning that this was out of my control and to focus on the things that I could control was a way that I learned to balance that type of anxiety.
That's really important. Thanks. Thanks for sharing that. So the anxiety about all the uncertainty.
Yeah, I just want to say that that's something that kind of always resonated with me too, was, you know, especially when your treatments or your course of treatments are such that, you know, maybe something doesn't work and you're trying to figure out what happens next, you know, those were always the times that were hardest for me, just kind of waiting for the next plan or the next, like, action to take. You know, the biggest one for me was that period where I was just waiting, you know, between sort of making that decision that I would have to go forward with a stem cell transplant and then waiting to, like, get it started. And it was, you know, they go through the consent and tell you everything that could happen, and I was kind of just searching for some sort of something to hang on to, but it was so hard to find. And, you know, I think, like Carolyn just said, it was ultimately about just kind of, you know, acknowledging and accepting that fear and realizing that, you know, I couldn't, maybe I couldn't make it go away, but sort of thinking about, like, what, you know, in a situation where I have so little control, what can I control? And I think that remembering where you do have agency is really helps you feel a little stronger and more ready to face your fears. And so ultimately it was just for me about, you know, telling myself that it's okay, you know, this is a completely legitimate fear and I can't make it disappear, but I'm going to make the decision to go forward with this treatment and just take it one day at a time, you know. And that kind of empowered me just enough to feel like I had some control.
I like how you said that in terms of allowing yourself to experience and acknowledge the fear and not tell yourself that you can't feel that way. Because I do think with anxiety, often when we tell ourselves that we can't feel anxious, sometimes the anxiety actually gets bigger in a certain way. So I think acknowledging it is really important, and what you said, what you both said about figuring out in this what can you control, which might be very different than the kind of things that you thought you could control. but really thinking about that is helpful and important, and how you can express yourself and controlling what you can at that moment. So did you have something to say? Did someone have something to say? I just wanted to think about, with all of you, the role for professional counseling or medication in terms of coping with your anxiety, your distress, things, the feelings and emotions that come along with having cancer and going through treatment. And although we know many of those feelings are very, very normal and are human and experienced by people who go through an illness, sometimes those feelings are so overwhelming that we need help with them, and we need to think about treatment for them in special ways. Did any of you have experience with that or want to share your experience with that? I think educating people about the variety of tools and ways we can cope with those overwhelming feelings is important.
I was given a connection to an oncology support program from the surgeon who gave me the news that I had cancer from the very beginning. And so they were there for me, even though I wasn't ready for it yet. They were there for me, and they talked to me or they emailed me. And it was wonderful knowing that they were there. And then when I was going through radiation, they had social workers who came and talked to us, which just made you feel like, you know, you're not alone. And when I was done with those aspects of my treatment, I started to participate at the oncology support program so that I could talk to other people with cancer. I could talk to social workers. I could talk to psychologists, whatever I needed. And even if I didn't want to talk to somebody, knowing they were there made such a big difference to what I felt. And now that I know I felt more fear, more anxiety, more stress than I would let on, because I'm so goofy by nature, knowing that they're there, I sit down with them much more often and talk.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good point, I think, Kat. Very, very good point indeed. Yeah. May I just go back to the previous question? Because what Chris said provoked quite a lot of thought in me about the whole issue of control and so on, and how much control we have over these things. And I don't know, again, it's from my background experience, I come from a perspective where being an infantry officer and trained in the military and all this sort of thing, trained to be a controller, trained to be a leader, and wanting everything to be in control, and that's in my natural personality, I suppose. But the faith aspect also tells me that I'm not in control at all. There's nothing I'm in control of. But there's somebody else that is, a higher power for me, you know, God. And so ultimately, I don't want to be fatalistic, and I don't want to be blasé about it, but that whole acknowledgement for me personally that however much I wanted to control and tried to control, ultimately I wasn't going to have that control. And so I sort of was able to come to a place where I simply said, in myself, well, I will do the best I can, that I will be led through this process, as I said earlier, day by day, and we'll just take it as it comes. There were two particular points. I'm sorry, I'll let somebody else jump in there if they want to.
I just wanted to acknowledge how important your spirituality was to you in your coping with the stress and anxiety related to what you went through. Spirituality can be very important for people.
Yeah, thank you. There were two moments in the whole process. Like Chris, you know, the process before the transplant, stem cell transplant, was was, you know, similar experience to him, really. There were two moments. The moment of the transplant itself was, I suppose, looking back, actually slightly amusing, because we sat there on the bed. It happened about 9 o'clock at night, and this bag was connected up, and the blood, the bone marrow sort of went in, and it was almost like an anticlimax afterwards. We thought, well, is this it? What's going to happen now? But on the other hand, the really anxious stress came about a month afterwards. I don't know whether it did for you, Chris, when I was getting the results, first 2 or 3 months, actually, monthly chimerism tests. Chimerism test tells you how much of the bone marrow is mine, how much is donor. And eventually, thank God, it's 100% donor. But in the first days, the first time, we were given a percentage, and I can't remember what it was, but my wife and I got that completely twisted around the other way. We were expecting that my cells, which of course weren't existing then anyway, had to be the 100%, and the donor had to go down to sort of pretty much 0%. And actually, the reality is the other way around. So we had a complete misunderstanding on that first chimerism, and we're sort of we felt a bit betrayed in one way or another, that the donor's percentage of my bone marrow was so high, because we were thinking it had to go down lower. But that was a stressful moment, and it was only when we talked to the oncologist that, you know, and unpacked that and discussed it, we suddenly realized, oh, we've got this the wrong way around. But that was pretty stressful. I've got a couple of comments on the therapist side as well.
It also often, Noel and others, I think when you're feeling stressed and anxiety, sometimes the anxiety can be so overwhelming that you also either hear information in a certain way or don't hear particular information that can even cause you more distress. So I think that anxiety can have that effect on people. Carolyn, did you have something you wanted to add to the question about seeking out mental health care and sort of?
I did, yeah. I wanted to say that I, with the first diagnosis and even with my second diagnosis, I felt like a failure. I thought that needing to see a therapist and a psychiatrist meant that I wasn't, you know, I wasn't beating my cancer in the right way. I wasn't the best cancer patient that I could be, and I really felt like I had failed. And through therapy, I did learn that that wasn't the case at all. That, you know, there is no handbook to how you handle cancer. It's too bad that there's not, but you really do need someone to walk this journey with you who understands the unique aspects to it and can help talk you through certain situations. And even with my second diagnosis, although I knew all of those things, I still thought I was handling things because I had certain tools that I had learned, and it was tough realizing that I was still struggling with the cancer and depression and, you know, again, going back and seeking therapy and meeting with my psychiatrist and really getting that emotional support that I needed is really turning me towards the right path that I need to be on. So,
do others have any other comments about seeking professional support in terms of coping with anxiety?
Yes. Again, I don't want to sort of power on about what you mentioned about the spirituality. For us, whilst I'm not averse to seeking therapists and psychiatrists, you know, that sort of aspect, the medical aspect of help like that, for us, we found that our anxiety was considerably relieved by going to the, if you like, the professional, but the spiritual professional. And when I got home, or during the time I was, I had a month in Boston after the transplant before I was allowed home, we had a couple of
Noel, I can't hear you. Uh, I can't hear Noel.
Sorry. I'm sorry, maybe I'm not speaking at the microphone, but I'm just saying the importance of, for us, having the professional spiritual help was all important, and particularly the what's known in the Christian churches, you know, the Eucharist, the Mass, Communion, different words for it, is we believe has a power for healing, and we believe we experience that. But when I got, we had a weekly visit from our pastor every Sunday, who would bring us that, and that for us was very fulfilling, and in fact I think completely took the role of the therapist, at you know, medical therapist. So that's how we dealt with it.
It seems like professional counseling was helpful for some of you, and some with spiritual counseling, and I was wondering, there's also other ways to express your emotions and deal with anxiety that might have a more creative or more physical nature. I was wondering if any of you had examples of that.
Well, that's exactly how I deal with everything. But I'm a professional artist and a clown, not just, you know, metaphorically speaking, I'm a clown. So I started doing daily self-portraits during my treatments to give me something to do. And after a week, I started creating these goofy characters. And I knew that when I looked back on everything that I was dealing with, I would see these portraits and it would look like I was having fun. And it did. And it really helped to cheer me up. Creativity is a cancer treatment. Norman Cousins' book, which I'm sure you all know of, Anatomy of an Illness According to the Patient, talks about that specifically. Most people just know that he used laughter for his treatment. But that's just the first chapter of the book. The rest of the book really talks about how creativity does alleviate a lot of the stress, the anxiety. It helps your attitude. It helps to boost your immune system. So I just made sure that that was part of my everyday treatment. I smile, I laugh, I sing, I dance every day. And I have the pictures to prove it.
That's a wonderful testimony, Kat. It really is. I love to hear that. I'm the opposite. I'm not creative at all. And my wife is quite creative, but I'm not creative. But to hear you say that, and that was so helpful for you, is just wonderful. Thank you.
Chris,
do you mind if I add something, Karen?
Oh, go ahead.
I got very involved in fundraising for cancer, as well as volunteering with Dana-Farber. That was something that was very cathartic for me. You know, the fundraising made me feel like I was doing something to hopefully one day find a cure and help along research. And the, you know, volunteering was, you know, allowing me to interact with other patients who had dealt with cancer. We may not have experienced the same things, but we're all traveling in this journey together. So any guidance that I could provide, or any guidance that they could provide to me, was beneficial and really was therapeutic to me.
Chris, did you have something you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, I think, and this might sort of address your previous question too, but I think, you know, what was really important for me was, as I kind of grew up really dealing with cancer, and you know, as a younger person, I think I learned, you know, I guess it took me a bit to realize just how important it was for me to address my, you know, make more of an effort and a more of a conscious effort to address anxieties and stress and fear and sad emotion, all my emotions, you know. I think, like, it's really easy to think about mental health issues as, you know, something that, you know, we sort of treat after the fact. And I found that thinking about it as something that I should, like, could engage with consistently was way more helpful. Kind of like, I like this thought of, you know, we have all these med lists, and there are things that you have as your standing dose, and there are things you take as needed. And I sort of had this realization that dealing with anxiety or my emotions was something that needed to be on my standing list, and it wasn't something that I should deal with as needed when it built up and became too much to handle. And for me, that meant just, you know, reminding myself to engage with it. And like I think a lot of people have already said, there are so many different ways that we can do that, you know. And for me, it started by taking the step to seek professional help. And you know, there are things that I can, there are times when, like, I can get out some of my emotions best to a professional, because I don't have to feel guilty that I'm burdening someone else that I love with these things that are troubling me, you know. I can sort of feel like I could say anything. But then there are times when, you know, you need to just talk to that person that you love, and, you know, sometimes the only way for me to, like, confront a certain emotion would be to just, like, be totally, you know, have a breakdown in front of my girlfriend or something. And then, you know, there are just so many different ways that I started exploring how can I find any outlet to sort of deal with so many different emotions and stressors. And so sometimes I felt that, you know, I want to be more, you know, I want more people to hear about my experience. So I, you know, started writing blog posts. And sometimes you just, you know, from that scale, you know, sometimes the best way to deal with the emotion might be to just deal with, like, kind of deal with it yourself in some way. So I started trying to do, like, I looked into things like Reiki or like meditation or anything that could just calm me down. So it was, for me, like, really helpful to develop what I kind of think of as a toolkit. And, you know, some things, some days work, and sometimes they're just not what you need at that time. And you know, but for me, just having all, you know, different ways to engage with those emotions helped me kind of keep up with it at a consistent level and manage all those fear, like all those worries and stresses, you know, kind of continuously, as opposed to letting them build up and become, you know, overwhelming, I guess.
I like your idea of a toolkit. I think that's a great way to see it, that certain days certain things work and other days other things work, and we all need options in terms of our toolkit, and everyone's toolkit looks a little bit different. And I think that's also important to realize, and for people watching this to realize, that of all of you, none of your toolkits look the same to me. I can't exactly see them all, but I think it all looks a little bit different. So I'm going to actually have us have one more question, and then we're going to see if there are some questions from some of the viewers. So I wanted to just end this portion with a question that is very sort of concrete and direct about, you know, tell me the pearls. What are the pearls of wisdom that you would have in a few sentences for each of you about what do you advise people in terms of how to deal with stress and anxiety related to cancer treatment? What are your parting thoughts?
What a great question. I have it in just a few words. enjoy your life. Even with a cancer diagnosis, you still get to enjoy your life. The big question is, how are you going to enjoy your life anyway?
Thank you. That's very helpful.
I would say that my advice would be, one of the kind of pearls of wisdom that I've learned is that I'm in control of the information that I give out to people. So cancer is very personal, and you know, not everyone needs to know every single thing about my diagnosis. So when I'm asked questions, I share what's comfortable. I share, you know, key pieces of information or what I feel is appropriate for the situation or the timing. And I keep little sayings in my back pocket, not, you know, literally, but figuratively, where, you know, if someone asks me how I'm feeling, I can say it's, you know, it's just another day, or, you know, doing the best that I can, or I have these little phrases that seem to get me out of a situation sometimes when someone takes me off guard with a question. So, but learning that I had the control to, you know, give out that information was really powerful for me.
Thanks, Carolyn.
That was a great answer, Carolyn. Thank you so much. That was helpful. I think for us, obviously, it's going to come from the spiritual aspect, and I think I probably want to say that even with a faith, a strong faith, it does not take the suffering, the anxiety, and the stress away completely. But it does enable us to have really what Kat said, you know, to enjoy, to get on with life, to take it as it comes, and to I describe it in terms of, it's given us great peace, huge peace, in fact, to be able to cope and carry on this fight. So I think that would be my input there.
Thank you.
I guess I think just remembering, you know, that it's just something that you need to engage with, you know, your feelings and your anxieties, and there are so many different ways you can do that. So just, you know, remembering, like I said, was just saying, to reach into that toolkit and find something is really important. And just remembering to give yourself a break, you know, because there's just so much we're dealing with that it's important to remember not to add stress to yourself too. So yeah, those are my
thanks for that.
Can I just add two words for me? I meant to mention prayer, I didn't mention it, and sometimes prayer, just simply saying help is a sufficient prayer, and gets you through the next minute, gets you through the next sometimes the next 5 seconds of anxiety and stress. And then eventually those build on each other, and you've suddenly realized, well, I got through today. Now I can get through tomorrow.
Thanks. So we're almost out of time, and I wanted to take an opportunity. I've asked all of you a lot of questions. I wanted to see if in the last 5 or 7 minutes of our time together today, if you have questions for each other.
I'd certainly like to engage Chris about GVHD, maybe offline separately. I didn't realize until you said at the beginning, Chris, that you are GVHD. I've just come through a horrible bout. It felt like torture a month ago of GVHD. I'm on the right side of it now, and it's getting back stabilized. But maybe you and I could engage on that somehow through Twitter or something.
Yeah, yeah. We can get you guys connected around that issue.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd be happy to talk to you.
Any other questions for each other?
I guess I would ask Chris as well. Did you experience loss of friendships or difficulty with people your own age when you were dealing with cancer? Because I know that I definitely did. So.
Yeah, I think, you know, I definitely did, especially just as a young adult, a lot of my, you know, I guess peers, just like me, haven't experienced, you know, anything close to a cancer diagnosis, and a lot of people really didn't know how to react to it, and it was, you know, that's a really hard thing, and I think something that younger people who get diagnosed with cancer deal with a lot, and that can be really hard, and you know, I think I was lucky. I had a few friends, and I had my girlfriend, and they all were just so supportive, you know. But it's, you know, there were also many people who I really just lost touch with, and you know, that is hard, but it also kind of made me really see, like, you know, which relationships I had in my life, and you know, which ones were really strong, and which ones, you know, so it's hard. It's definitely a hard thing, and I definitely experienced that, especially when I was first diagnosed. I was in high school, and I sort of, you know, that was something I had a really difficult time kind of coming to terms with, sort of figuring out that, you know, trying to figure out, like, what that all meant, you know, and building myself back up from that. But ultimately, I think, you know, it really made me realize which relationships were the ones that were really strong and meaningful. So
I would agree. So
thanks. I think the way relationships change can be a big source of stress and anxiety. And some of those relationships we can negotiate, and some we can't at the time negotiate. Maybe in the future we can negotiate them. But I appreciate that as something that really contributes to a lot of how people experience cancer and the emotional issues related to it. So I think we have time for one more question from one of you to another one, if there is one. If not, we're almost out of time. So is there one more question? So it sounds like we are all going to wrap up now, and I want to first thank you for all of your wonderful insights and what you've shared, and your ability to kind of be honest and really help others understand how to cope with cancer. And I want to just remind you that you can follow our panelists on Twitter to stay up to date on their journeys. And you can also follow Dana-Farber at Dana-Farber Twitter for more resources for people living with cancer. So thank you all so much for joining us and taking the time today. And I really appreciate all your insights and your wisdom.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, pleasure. Thank you. And may God bless each one of us.
Thank you.